are near, my heart is at peace. Hurry home.
Yes! He's killed the Empress! I'll see you beheaded for this, Corvo.
My dear Corvo, what a sad hand fate has dealt you. The beloved Empress dead, and everyone thinks you're the killer. But we know what really happened, don't we? You don't want to end your life to the sound of idiots cheering as your head hits the muck, do you? Let's see if we can do better. And to make things interesting, my mark. Consider it a gift.
All members of the watch, we are now under high alarm. Stay alert and contain any suspicious person on site. Attention all citizens. By order of the Lord Regent and the City Watch, all contaminated buildings are strictly off-limits.
Signs of sickness and plague must be reported to the authorities at once. By the laws of the Lord Regent, report all sleepers.
Clear them out.
No!
Happened again. Someone's pulled the rug out from under you. An empire at your feet, and you've lost it all. Be honest, did you really deserve any of it? More important, what would you do to get it back? Careful, there's always a price to pay. What you decide will ripple across the years. Blood in the gutters and corruption on the wind. It'll be fun watching this unfold. What will you do with the power I've given you? How will you make your mark on this wretched world?
But I know who you are, Emily Kaldwin. Nothing is an accident. Everything is in motion. All of it has led you to this exact second in time.
You never saw me as a threat. You don't know me. But you will.
So it begins.
This is the story of a throne at the heart of an empire, casting a shadow over three lives. The Empress, brought down by assassins, the daughter who watched her mother die, and the man who would have torn out his heart to keep them both safe. Now his lessons have made young Emily strong, but with an empire at stake, will that be enough?
Citizens of Kardak, disloyalty and sedition will not be tolerated.
Blood spilled from the throne in Dunwall laps against Karnaka's distant shores.
No one knows what's happened.
In the Jewel of the South, there are answers. But new riddles, too. In this city are unimaginable wonders. Soldiers with clockwork minds and electromagnetic hearts. Inventions that will elevate every citizen or crush them beneath metallic feet. Young Empress reaches into the void itself. Her father touched the void too and paid a heavy price. There's no one like Delilah. Survival and ambition, art and magic, with a cunning that makes sycophants of those around her. Now she's got the throne, but her eyes are set on a much greater prize. In Karnaka, there's always a choice. Mercy or revenge, savior or assassin. What would you give up to take back what's yours?
His name was Esmond Roseborough, and Dunwall was his last hope. He had dedicated his life to knowledge and progress, but throughout the Isles, no one would listen. The whale yards were no place for a natural philosopher, but he had nowhere else to go. The poor and hungry gathered there, hoping for a few scraps, and Roseborough wondered if he would soon share their fate. But then, he saw something. Something that made him realize his entire life's work was a waste, and it brought a smile to his face. Roseborough's discovery breathed new life into Dunwall. It made him rich beyond his wildest dreams. But he never took his success for granted. So when young Anton Sokolov came to him with a radical new idea, he couldn't help but give him a chance. Sokolov's ideas ushered Dunwall into a new era of technology. But over time, Roseborough learned that sometimes progress comes at too great a cost. It's a funny thing, ambition. It can take one to sublime heights or harrowing depths. And sometimes they are one and the same. Roseborough learned that lesson all too well. Once there was a boy who knew only fear and loneliness. The boy had heard stories of better days when Dunwall was a peaceful place. But to him, that's all they were. Stories. Adults could be cruel, but it was the other children who were truly wicked. So he did the only thing he could, hide in the alleys away from the other boys. Find comfort from his only real friend. That night he realized he wasn't alone. As the outsider approached, the boy barely even noticed as his hand began to itch. From then on, the boy felt different. He was no longer afraid, and he sought out his tormentors. He swarmed over them with the stuff of nightmares. No one would be safe. But he wasn't careful. A gift so powerful can be taken away as easily as it is given. All it takes is a single bite. As his eyes began to weep, he searched in vain for the outsider, but found himself alone once again. He only wanted to see the outsider one last time to thank him, for he would no longer live in fear. For what little life he had left. Piero couldn't remember when he'd last slept. The Empress was dead. Dunwall was crumbling and the plague was spreading. At night, the dreams haunted him. They were always the same. Visions of a young boy dying an agonizing death. But he knew it was no dream. For Piero, the work was always the same. A handful of coin. A whisper. It should have been easy. Instead, he'd lost his way. He was a gifted man, but now, even this simple task seemed impossible. Rats, disease, death, the nightmare had become an obsession. But when the dreams came this time, the boy was gone, and there was a hole in the world. He looked into the void and saw death itself staring back at him. And finally, Piero knew what he had to do. It would be his greatest creation. Who it was for did not concern him. In due time, all would be revealed.
beloved Empress dead, and everyone thinks you're the killer, what will you do, Corvo? Dowd, my old friend, what ending will you make for yourself? How the years pass and the bodies fall.
6 months, the city writhed and changed. For 6 months, I tried to forget what I'd done to the Empress and her little girl. Whatever doom was coming, I deserved it. But not yet.
Thank you.
Sun Wall burns to the ground, one corner of the Empire will still know your story. Dowd, the Knife of Dunwall. Killer of an Empress.
Black-eyed bastard knew that when my blade stilled the Empress's heart, delivered her daughter to the Lord Regent's men, everything would fall to pieces. And I'm in a strange duel with a mad witch named Delilah.
Are you afraid of me, Dowd?
You should be.
Dowd. His heart was made of glass. All it took was a dead empress to crack him apart.
We make our choices and take what comes. And sooner or later, in ways we can't always fathom, the consequences come back to us.
On site.
more time, old friend.
We've both seen cities go bad before. And I have to wonder whether you're gonna give it that final nudge.
Killers in back alleys. Killers fighting over thrones. What does it matter?
No one is innocent. Tell me how to kill Delilah.
And I were hunting.
If you want to walk out with a piece of Delilah, you better be ready to leave something behind.
This is the world as it should be. And there's no place in it for you.
Everyone you love. Everything you hold dear. I'll destroy.
Oh, royal protector. I welcome you to try. And die at my hands.
I'm going to end your reign soon, Delilah. There's no place for monsters like you in this world.
Look around you. You haven't been watching the dark corners of the world. Maybe living in a palace has made you soft.
We have an unexpected visitor.
I present the lost sister of Jessamine called Delilah Kaldwin.
Impossible.
I'm here to relieve you of your crown.
But someone yanked the rug from under your feet. You've lost your throne and your father. And I promise, Delilah won't just give them back.
No!
So, what are you prepared to do about it? Your Imperial Majesty. Delilah's playing the long game. And now she's an empress. How many of your own subjects are you ready to slaughter? And what are you willing to become?
Take it! Holy shit!
We'll be face to face soon. Delilah.
Halt!
Anyone here? Show yourself!
It's not my job to clean up. Give me a handful of the clockwork.
Thank you.
need to find Anton Sokolov.
Welcome to my home, stranger. The door is always open to those with the will to pass the threshold. If you're here by appointment, then proceed and bide your time. Otherwise, I'd be remiss if I didn't inform you about the defensive mechanisms employed here, which are quite formidable. Many have entered without invitation. The myriad as the fish in the ocean.
Ah, the space behind the walls.
Think this thing can see what we're doing?
No. When they're like this, they're blind. They can still hear, though. They'll wake up at any loud noise or if a fight breaks out.
Still kind of creepy. I have to work hard to ignore them.
I find it kind of exciting. Like being watched, but not really.
Job.
But where is Jindosh?
Oh, it's one of the clockworks. But what is it doing? Is this some sort of maze?
It's obviously a chamber for conducting experiments and tests.
How would you know? You can barely wind a watch.
Jindosh isn't here. Do you suppose we're in danger?
I'm starting to weaken my desire to purchase anything. Am I seeing things?
Something's wrong.
Something.
I feel so empty right now.
Uncertainty.
Kaldwin?
Anton, save your strength. I came to take you out of here. You'll be safer in the carriage, Sokolov. Then, I owe Jindosh a visit.
The Duke's
circle is full of clever bastards, but no one is like Jindosh. His home is supposed to be full of marvels, and there's a reason people are afraid of his mansion. Jindosh won't care who you are or what you want. He looks at you like you're a puzzle to be taken apart. Has a strange beauty to it, but all such places must eventually come to ruin. Who would build something like this, and why?
Someone's activated one of the mechanisms in my house.
Jindosh.
Welcome, visitor. My home is always open. It's one of my great curiosities, seeing how the common mind navigates these shifting rooms. I'm Kirin Jindosh, but you must know that. I invite you to continue, stranger. Just come up the stairs. Meet with me face to face in the upper hall. That's it. You're almost there. Come into the gallery so I can see you. In part, I made this place for luxury and spectacle, I suppose, but it's more than that. This place is a testament to engineering itself. Before you stands an invention that will endure beyond my time. The Jindosh Clockwork Soldier, my greatest creation. There you are, magnificent. Now that I see you, I've worked out who you are. Not a hired cutthroat. Your clothes are too fine. An aristocratic thrill seeker? That's closer. You trained with weapons formerly, but are not a salon fencer. There's a good back alley in your movements. All that, and you have your father's eyes. Your imperial majesty. Welcome, Lady Emily Kaldwin.
Impressive, Jindosh. Then you must also know why I'm here.
I'd assume my involvement with the Duke brought you to my door. Or maybe you're after washed-up Anton Sokolov, comfortably residing in the assessment chamber. Either way, come find me and take whatever it is you seek. But if you fall, I'll have your body carried to my lab for dissection and study.
I'll see you soon, Jindosh.
Until then.
Clockwork soldiers, there's an interloper in my home.
Combat protocol 6. Each new visitor is another test for the Clockwork Soldiers. Each makes them better. Tactical mode.
Quarry lost. Unauthorized presence.
Entering combat safe.
You consider the Grand Guard personnel protecting you to be quarry, but you get to best one of my clockwork soldiers. Extraordinary.
You won't get away! Got you!
It's very impressive that you survived, Delilah, and made it down here to Kaldwin.
The space behind the walls.
Where is she, damn it?
Extra
diagnostic playback loop. Still idling.
All movements are linked. Everything has a purpose. It's all connected, you see. One of the finest views in all Karnaka.
It's a long way down. There's another choice here. With this machine, maybe you won't have to die after all, Jindosh. Not sure I'd call it mercy.
Playback for detection registered. Playback. Playback for detection registered. Back for detection. Aristocratic profile, but hostile. Combat Protocol 8.
Search. Playback for Corvo. Housing breach.
With you yet.
Come on. Don't have time for games.
Where is she?
Karnaka, my Karnaka. Brothers and sisters of my blood. And all the people who make this great city trust the law. This is the Duke, but you must all know my voice by now.
What?
Stay back, war. We'll give it to them. No matter how many of you I have
Come
to sacrifice,
here.
Sarkonis will fight for Delilah to the bitter end.
beneath my skin. Careful now. I might not let you leave.
Hey, something wrong?
I don't feel so well.
Impossible!
Huh? Come back here! Ah!
Ah!
On the streets of Karnaca, compliance is mandatory.
Tear you to pieces.
Anything going on at the Grand Palace?
Too far away.
Your debt to society, Burn.
is the stealth playthrough of the Golden Cat mission from Dishonored. Here to walk you through it are co-creative directors Raphael Colantonio and Harvey Smith.
Hello, I'm Harvey Smith, and I'm with Raphael Colantonio, and we are the co-creative directors of Dishonored.
Dishonored is a first-person action game where you play the role of a supernatural assassin.
You play Corvo Attano, who is the bodyguard of the Empress, the royal protector, and he is, at the beginning of the game, falsely accused of her murder.
There are many ways to play the game. This is one of the premises of the game. So we provide a set of tools to the player. We provide an environment which is open and with various ways to get inside the buildings. And the simulation is here to allow the player to explore and to experiment with the mechanics. And really, it's up to the player to play its own way, and it's up to the systems to resolve the player's intention.
All right, the mission in Dishonored that we're showing you today takes place in a bathhouse called the Golden Cat. And so even in the middle of the terrible plague that is gripping the city of Dunwall, the corrupt aristocrats are partying like there's no tomorrow. And in the mission today, you have to track down the Pendletons, Lords Custis and Morgan Pendleton, who are corrupt members of Parliament.
We're going to play this demo twice. The first playthrough is going to be stealthy, as non-lethal as possible.
One of the things about Dishonored is the player is highly mobile. So there's not only, you know, sprint and slide and climb and lean, things like that you'd expect in a first-person action game with a stealth component. But we also have supernatural powers like Blink that he was using to make a short-range teleport across the balcony.
Here we see the player collecting a rune. He's using the heart to locate those runes. Those runes are used to upgrade your powers. There are multiple ways to infiltrate a building. In this case, we believe there is 8 or 9 ways in. You could go through the main door, or through one of the open windows or breaker windows, or behind the building. There's also various conduits, like if you possess a rat or if you possess a fish, you can go through the water. In this case, in this playthrough, we are going to show how we infiltrate the building by possessing a fish.
You can pick up lots of little story bits by watching the characters and eavesdropping. But here, the player is looking for a way inside the Golden Cat.
I have to keep this position. He says to bring a bottle, I bring a bottle. He says to bring food, I bring food. He says to undress, I undress.
So now we're inside the building. Can't ask for more than that. Eavesdropping and overhearing conversation is a very important thing in Dishonored. In this case, overhearing the conversation between those two women give us the location of the targets. And you can see the target, the markers are actually being updated based on the conversation that we heard.
Oh, he's not the worst.
Whenever you enter this mission, the position of the Pendleton Lords is dynamic, so there are several different places they can be.
You can see the level of alertness of the AI. So in this case, there were like those two little indicators on the head of the woman because she almost saw you. And that's feedback so that the player can know if he's currently well hidden or if he's going to be detected.
Here's another note in the world that also duplicates the information that the player gained by eavesdropping earlier, so he now knows where each of the two Lords Pendleton are.
With any of our ladies,
Here are the players peeking through a keyhole and eavesdropping on a guard and the madame of the Golden Cat.
You can notice that the sound is muffled behind closed doors, and the sound actually propagates based on the geometry, which is really interesting for stealth gameplay because it helps you locate very well where the NPCs are around you.
Here the player is choking out Madame Prudence and taking her key, which is the master key to the Golden Cat. He could have just taken the key and left, but instead he wanted to loot the room, so he left her unconscious. So he could have snuck by without alerting her, he could have killed her, or he could leave her choked out on the floor. It's all options.
Signs of the sickness.
Talk to that nice girl again. The one I told you about.
You realize you're at the Golden Cat, right?
Yeah, but she's different. She really likes me.
Idiot. She likes your money, not you.
You're just jealous.
Shut up.
Dunstan. The Pendletons are here. You're supposed to be on duty.
Given the fact that the player can approach the game in a variety of different ways, very, very violently or stealthy, killing everyone or literally killing no one as they play through, it feels very different when you play the game each time. It feels like you're authoring your own path. Not only are there these different stylistic ways to approach the game, but there are many different powers you can buy, and no player can have them all. And then there are also different pathways running through the map, as we've mentioned. Here the player has learned that one of the Pendleton lords is in the steam room downstairs, so he's descending into the hammam area.
Though we'd make even more if they didn't blow it on prostitutes.
My cousin's swarming at their mom.
He says the slaves have dug half a mile down, so deep they're dying by the dozen from collapse.
For this playthrough, he's going to attempt to take out the corrupt members of parliament without sounding any alarms. So he doesn't want these guards to see him or fire their guns or yell for help.
Now, there are several ways to access the target. One would be to find the key for this door, because it's an unbreakable door. Another one would be to use a fish, and which is in the pond, and infiltrate this way. The other way is to make it look like an accident, and so this is what we're going to do here.
The screams lasted hours. He begged and let him die.
Terrible. And I think I've lost.
Oh,
what is that noise?
Oh no. No, no, no.
So as Raph said, you know, we made this look like an accident, right? So the target's been assassinated, but it looks like an accident. However, there's also a completely non-lethal way to do this. Custis and Morgan Pendleton are slave owners who run a mine, and so by doing a side quest for a crime boss named Slackjaw, He will take them for you, shave their heads, obscure their identities, and put them to work for years in their own minds. So it's a way to accomplish the mission and neutralize the targets without actually killing them. And across the game, all of the targets can be dealt with this way for the very thorough player who doesn't want to kill them. So here the player is sneaking in stealth mode, and he's using his dark vision power to see through walls and see the view cones of the characters, the guards, and he's moving up on the second target.
He didn't get a good look.
Did he say what he wanted?
I hear he didn't say a word, but he went through the place like the outsider himself.
Maybe the plague's driven him crazy.
He didn't fucking...
Mark me.
You
get that mask off, and you'll see him.
One of Dowd's. That's how he fought.
Come on. Fucking longer do I have to fuck them.
So many people ask us, can you possess anything, like even the target? And the answer is yes, you can possess the target, which is what we're going to demonstrate here.
My overseer, for all I care, I've never been this drunk.
Some of my friends say I look like Lady Boyle.
Waverly? That lucky trollop. If I'd found those crystal deposits on my estate, I'd be throwing parties too. I'd be buying the Lord Regent's favor too, instead of begging for money from my cousins.
I didn't mean to upset you, my lord.
Wait. I thought, maybe you should dress up like her. I think I should like to teach her a lesson.
Lord Pendleton? Are you okay?
So because these things can happen dynamically almost anywhere, the lines are unscripted for characters commenting on whether, you know, you look sickly or not when you're possessing someone. So here the players used a sleep dart to knock out this courtesan.
So here we're going to demonstrate one of the ways we can combine powers. Here, in this case, the player jumped off the building and would have killed himself normally, but instead what he did is that he used the possession power on that woman and therefore projected himself into her body and then could walk around this way without dying.
What's happening to me?
Those are things that when we designed the powers, we did not know the extent of the possibilities, and then like looking at players, finding them out is really, really satisfying for us. And this is the end of our stealth playthrough.
In this playthrough, we try a more direct approach of the Golden Cat mission.
Okay, so this time the player has done a different sequence leading through the streets leading up to the Golden Cat, and it has come in through the rooftops. So a lot of vertical movement in the game, a lot of mobility. In the previous area, you can get dropped off in the river, and you're here to kill Custis and Morgan Pendleton. And therefore, there are several different ways to enter the Golden Cat area. In this playthrough, we're going to do very brutally.
Need to get the men in position.
The ivory room. All I can tell you is it's very heavily soundproofed. I'll leave the rest to your imagination. Custis is easy with me.
Why would anyone pay for that?
Rats. Plague. Elixir. Bunch of crap.
Huh?
This is a drop attack.
Talk to that nice girl again. The one I told you about.
Yep. You're at the Golden Cat, right?
Yeah.
Obviously, playing this way has got consequences. Some of them is that we track the number of death and innocents that the player kill, and this derives the ending, but also derives some of the little story beats all along the game. And besides, playing this way is actually very consuming in terms of resource. So the player uses those resources like powers and his mana and his health potions, and he has to use them carefully.
Might be worth checking out.
Take out his legs.
So here the players stop time just before the guards have fired their pistols, and he's planting a spring razor there. When time resumes, it will kill them both. Game's combat with a sword, the melee combat, involves blocking and counterattacks if the blocking is timed correctly.
I hear you.
I'll have you whipped and put to work in the...
So both targets have been assassinated. Summoning rats. Once the rats are in the world, they're like little AIs. So sometimes the guards win, sometimes the rats win. And here the player has possessed one of his own rats and is now getting away. And that's the end of the violent, messy playthrough of the Golden Cat.
So this is a very different area. The previous area with posh and pretty, this is like desolated, abandoned. This is actually the area where there are weepers. It's called the Flooded District. And there are those tall boys here that are preventing the weepers. The weepers are the plague-infected people. Those tall boys, their job is to prevent them from accessing the rich area. So they will shoot at the weepers and they will shoot at anything that tries to get through, including the player. Here we'll using wind blast to bounce back the arrows at the turbos.
Using wind blast to knock the tall boys' phosphorescent arrows back at them is another combination of game mechanics that we did not plan for, but players found it quite fun, so we made some small changes to help support it. These Stiltwalker guards, the tall boys as they're called, have vulnerable tanks of whale oil on their backs that they use for their incendiary arrows. And so periodically the player is shooting at those tanks, stopping time, trying to get behind them. The shields all around them are actual breakable wooden shields, so they absorb some of the player's shots, but periodically the player breaks one of them off.
Here the player just possessed a tall boy, and he's going to escape the area through those wall of lights here via tall boy.
So the wall of light is a Tesla-like security device that's a powerful electrical field, and the guards at the beginning of their shift are attuned to it so they can walk through it, but the player cannot unless he hacks it.
Thank you for watching. In Dishonored, the ideal assassin will use a variety of powers and tactics to remain hidden for as long as possible. But the best assassins are never seen at all. An enemy's line of sight is limited to what a person would actually see. When using the dark vision power, their field of view is illustrated with a shaded cone of light. Enemy peripheral vision is weaker at a distance. At short or medium range, enemies will see you if you're in their field of view.
Huh? What the fuck?
However, at a distance, darkness can function as an effective cloak. Leaning allows you to peek around corners while remaining hidden behind cover.
I'm gonna say we found one of Slackjaw's men inside, all dead and bloody.
Noise level is also important to stealth. The faster you run, the more noise you will create.
Someone's over there.
Crouching will enter stealth mode and silence your movement entirely. Sound can also be used to distract enemies and throw them off your trail.
I hear you, bastard. You gotta be here somewhere.
Someone skulking around.
Watch.
Each of these disciplines should be taken into account while sneaking, and none of them are foolproof when employed separately.
other places, where they train the overseers to be real religious.
I know when you're here somewhere.
It's gonna be bad.
Okay, hold it. Someone get over.
No!
To make one of those games that supports all the values that we've always liked to do at Arkane.
We both realized that we knew games that we were sort of specialists around, like we loved as players.
I believe there's never been any first-person game where you play the role of a supernatural assassin.
In the game, you play Corvo, who is the royal protector to the Empress, and you get falsely accused of her murder.
So you get thrown to jail, you're gonna escape the jail, and then it's up to you to get revenge, set things right, and restore the kingdom.
We wanted to make a game that supported the action player, supported the slow-paced exploration player, supported the super fast-paced guy. Our primary goal was to create a unique, exotic world for the player to explore.
I only deal with design direction, which means that I oversee the concept design process and the fiction. So Raphael and Harvey, as creative directors, had the input of the overall gameplay experience, and then we started knitting together story, visuals, architecture, and Sebastian would take it from there and work with the theme.
On a la même approche de la création d'univers graphiques, de monde. C'est de en fait, on partage la même passion visuelle. Et en fait, donc on a cherché les meilleurs caractères modeleurs qu'il nous fallait, et on les a trouvés un petit peu en Europe. On les a pas fait venir au studio parce qu'on s'est dit il faut qu'ils gardent en fait leur univers et leur façon de travailler.
Alors, en tant que caractère artiste, on a fait beaucoup de recherches pour arriver à capturer l'essence de la morphologie anglo-saxonne pour que nos personnages en fait s'intègrent bien dans cet univers qui est particulier, quoi, qui a une forte identité graphique.
We worked very closely on the characters. We used both mocap animation and keyframe animation. Everything we did with the mocap, we reworked it with keyframe to add a stylized layer on it to match the stylized character we have.
Donc mon travail, c'est de gérer donc tous les aspects techniques du gameplay, par exemple les pouvoirs, tout ce qui est intelligence artificielle. En tant que programmeur, il faut vraiment penser à toutes les possibilités que le joueur pourra avoir sur le jeu. Raph Hervé arrive des fois avec des demandes de design assez spéciales.
The mechanics are the most important thing. The interactivity is the most important thing in any video game. It's what's central to the medium. But at the same time, we love the narrative layer. We love the sense of being in a gloomy space that you can slowly explore and that feels like no one else has ever been there. You know, it feels like your experience.
As the experience is changing at each corner, we have to be aware of that as level designers. We have to take care of every possible situation.
Supernatural assassin in a steampunk city, new IP, brand new concept. These are all big challenges. At any given moment, you could go left, you can go right, you can go over the roof, you can possess a fish and swim into the place that you're sneaking into. You can approach things violently with the alarms ringing. No one can ever know you were there. And you could kill everyone, every guard, every servant, every, you know, civilian, or you can kill no one in our game. Those are choices that are in the water around you as you play.
Dishonored, for me, first of all, represents adding a new fictional place on the map of important non-existing cities. I draw and I paint, and I was an industrial designer, so technically I was formed to reproduce things that don't exist in a very realistic way. And my tools are mainly light, architecture, and composition. So science fiction cities are my specialty. Industrial designers are again formed and trained to create things that don't exist and to make them appealing. And industrial design in itself is fiction. I specialized in advanced prototypes for non-existing cars, which are absolutely dream objects. And that's why the training is very useful. And historically, people like Sid Mead, who's designed Blade Runner, was an industrial designer, and he had the attention to detail and to craftsmanship to make up a world and make it very believable. So it's a very obvious relationship between science fiction and industrial design.
So in Dishonored, you play a supernatural assassin in a steampunk city called Dunwall. And the game has what I would describe as a non-photorealistic art style, led by Sebastian Maton and Victor Antonov. When we first started the project, Raph and I kept saying, this is London 1666. It was the last year of the plague and the year of the Great Fire. The city of London at that point is pivotal to the world and pivotal to history.
The early creative influences were historical architectural pictures of London and maps of London. Start with a location. Where is this taking place? All kinds of representations from different artists, painters, photographers, and filmmakers.
As a visual designer, Victor works kind of like a historian. He really proceeds with what-if scenarios. So, okay, what if instead there was this event happening in history?
We looked at specific rooftops, specific smokestacks, and facade ornaments that were very specific only to London and to no other city.
When the first design come back is that it looks very real, even though it's not, but it's kind of believable because our brain kind of process it in a way which just looks like, oh wow, that looks like a place that could exist. And that's why I think his methodology is so powerful to people.
On a étudié en gros les fogs, la nuit, la pluie, les skies qui sont très bas en fait et qui pèsent sur l'expérience du joueur. C'était vraiment une approche qu'on avait de pas faire un jeu où il fait soleil très beau. C'est comment infiltrer la lumière. Donc c'est tout ce qu'on a étudié en allant à Londres. Et ensuite pour le retranscrire dans le jeu, il a fallu faire un petit peu de développement technique pour essayer de modifier la façon dont réagit la lumière avec les éléments du jeu vidéo, c'est-à-dire dans le brouillard, si on peut faire des haze et faire bloomer nos lights. C'est un bon setup pour un jeu vidéo. Et c'est une ville qui comporte une rivière, donc c'était très important pour nous, pour les missions qu'on fait dans notre jeu. En fait, on n'a pas l'approche classique du jeu vidéo. On a vraiment voulu revenir à des bases classiques d'art pur, c'est-à-dire les références qu'on a. Elles n'ont rien à voir avec... on ne fait pas de recherche sur Google, on ne cherche pas à faire de choses génériques, on veut vraiment créer quelque chose d'unique.
But the more we worked on the game, the more two things began to happen. As Raph and I and the team collaborated with Victor Antonov and Sebastian Maton, we started moving the game forward and forward in time, you know, until we eventually got to some sort of 1800s. We also moved further and further away from the real world and eventually just said, okay, this is the city of Dunwall.
We were somewhere in this time period where there's no a lot of technology, but there's a lot of mechanical technology going on. So we based everything on suspension, steam, and basic fuel. We wanted to bring some rock and roll into that and some modern elements. So we started adding more science fiction element, pulling it forward in time and including technologies from probably mid-19th century. So this was just one foundation, one layer. Up on this layer, we built what happened to the city 30 years later, 70 years later, etc. Technology and the machines in Dishonored have a specific narrative function. They tell the story of the ruler of the country who has a flair for industrial design and progress. So he's building bridges and buildings and fences and devices to modernize the city and to crush and oppress people as well.
The whaling trade takes off, and there's a brilliant inventor called Sokolov, who's for us a little bit Rasputin, a little bit Da Vinci, a little bit John Dee, and he invents some devices and takes advantage of the volatile whale oil, and then the oppressive government begins to use those devices against the people as a sort of security layer.
The whale oil industry in Dishonored is manifested and represented through visual elements and design elements like ships and boats. And all that suggests that the world is bigger than the city, and you have an ocean and you have foreign different lands and maybe colonies. So you have these mysterious ships bringing these strange animals, because they're not regular whales, they're Dunwall whales. So you see them through harbors and rivers and through the coast, and the whale ships expand the scope of the city. The characters and the character design in Dishonored are no different than the architectural design on the design of the light. We wanted to get into the identity of these characters. We looked into British morphology. How are the eyes set? How's the nose? How's the skin? Play with the grotesque and with the beautiful, and we stylize this into a variety of very real faces that have a backstory and a meaning to them.
On a travaillé avec des gens un peu à travers toute l'Europe et qui étaient vraiment des spécialistes en fait de l'anatomie, pour essayer de ne pas perdre l'intention qu'on avait mis dans les visuels au départ. Et on a pris des gens qui étaient spécialisés par exemple dans les silhouettes et dans les vêtements, dans la découpe des plis, la façon dont travaille un jean ou un pantalon. On ne voulait pas justement que ça ressemble à des personnages de jeux vidéo avec des jambes en tube et quelques polygones pour donner de l'effet ou juste des shaders. C'est-à-dire qu'on vraiment travaille la silhouette, c'est-à-dire que nos personnages, on a une approche de loin, parce que c'est un jeu de combat, donc on détecte les personnages de loin. Et on a besoin aussi d'avoir un fort caractère quand ils sont très près.
Ce qui rend vraiment les personnages de Dishonored uniques, c'est le fait qu'on a voulu les typer dès le début, en fait. On est parti dans cette stylisation. Et par exemple, au niveau des proportions,
Si je repense au City Guard, en fait, qui est un combattant, on n'a pas hésité à lui grossir les mains, à réduire sa boîte crânienne, pour vraiment qu'il ait le physique qui reflète ce qu'il fait dans le jeu. Et à l'opposé, on a par exemple les aristocrates qui sont beaucoup plus élancés, avec des fronts plus hauts, qui sont assez hautains, en fait, qui ont des visages vraiment, vraiment durs.
Ensuite, la deuxième approche, en fait, c'est de les passer en modélisation, en 3D pour le jeu. Et le but, c'est de ne pas perdre l'essence qu'on a dans la peinture, parce que c'était carrément de la peinture qu'on avait, c'était pas juste des croquis. Et garder ça en 3D, donc là, la contrainte, c'était plutôt technique, c'est comment garder quelque chose un peu de vivant et pas de tout générique, tout lisse.
En fait, ce travail de stylisation qu'on a réalisé sur nos personnages, on a aussi voulu l'appliquer sur nos animaux. C'est pas des animaux qu'on a l'habitude de voir, ils sont vraiment particuliers. Et là, j'ai en tête l'exemple du Wolfhound, où justement, on a pris un chien, mais on l'a mélangé aussi avec un peu de crocodile, un peu de girafe, pour le rendre vraiment unique et qui a un côté fantastique dans notre univers. On a fait une silhouette très forte, il se déplace vraiment d'une manière très particulière. C'est pas un chien qu'on pourrait croiser dans la rue tous les jours.
For Dishonored, we worked with Blind Light, which is a great company out in LA, who not only helped us find some really great actors to fill all the roles, but also we worked with a few key people that we picked out that you would call like celebrity talent. You know, the game is mostly an action game, but it's also got some role-playing game-based elements. For some of the characters, we you know, had a list of people we wanted to go after. Brad Dourif plays our character, Piero, who's a craftsman, artificer, natural philosopher.
Damn Sokolov! He will haunt me to my grave!
Chloe Grace Moretz was good enough to lend her voice to a character named Emily, who's quite important.
I love getting in the booth and just kind of playing with the different voices and sounds and stuff you can make and trying to really get the acting through onto the video game.
Susan Sarandon, I'm older, so I'm a big fan of hers from even as far back as the Rocky Horror Picture Show days. And she plays an interesting character that I don't want to say too much about right now. So those guys bring their own ideas to what the character's feeling and the intensity. And so just talking purely in narrative terms, I think the voice actors add a level of polish and help the player just sort of like empathize with what's going on.
I want the Dishonored world to leave a souvenir and a memory in the player as if they had really been to this place and it moved them. And I hope it would stay in fiction as one of the places that will give people goosebumps and shivers.
The thing we really wanted to do was give the player decisions to make, give the player choices and have some consequences to those choices. And some have lightweight or subtle consequences, and some are purely aesthetic.
Choice matter because in the media of video game, you can make choices where the movies doesn't allow you to make choices. So having the consequences to what you do and seeing how the simulation deals with your choices, it feels like the player has full ownership of his experience.
My goal is that everything that the player wants to do, he should be able to do it. As you can go everywhere, then it has to be functional everywhere. If he sees a door, it's an opponable door. If he sees a roof, he should be able to climb there, and he knows that this is a valid path.
As you guide Corvo through the world, as you see this world from a first-person perspective, you can constantly approach the game with all-out violence or subtlety, like, you know, you can be very surgical in how you move into an environment and how you deal with the assassination target.
Ce qui est vraiment très très intéressant dans Dishonored, c'est la possibilité pour le joueur de vraiment inventer son histoire, on va dire. Il peut vraiment jouer le jeu de la façon dont il a vraiment envie. Il peut très bien jouer au jeu sans jamais tuer personne, ou alors être une bête sauvage et attaquer tout le monde, mais ça aura des conséquences dans le jeu.
I feel like we might have made the first assassination game where you don't actually have to kill anybody.
Donc l'IA dans Dishonored est assez particulière dans le sens où il faut qu'elle réagisse vraiment à tout ce que le joueur est capable de faire, que ce soit de par ses pouvoirs ou que le joueur peut peut être assez furtif par rapport aux IA. Dans Dishonored, le joueur a la possibilité donc de jouer de différentes façons. Et s'il choisit la façon vraiment furtive, essayer de...
There's really no reason for you to listen to me.
If you ever need steady work, you come see me.
Écouter ce que l'IA va dire. Il peut écouter les conversations, il peut obtenir quelques indices en fait sur ce qui se passe, sur comment arriver à résoudre sa mission. Oui, donc le joueur va pouvoir utiliser des combinaisons de pouvoirs assez variées. Par exemple, donc il va pouvoir arrêter le temps, commencer à utiliser l'arbalète pour tirer sur les différents ennemis. Les flèches vont prendre le cours normal du temps, tous les ennemis dans la pièce vont mourir. Il peut utiliser ça de façon... il peut utiliser des combinaisons complètement incroyables. Je pense que on va être assez étonné de ce que les joueurs vont être capables de faire.
So when people play Dishonored, and once in a while they figure out something that just feels utterly creative to them and that they wouldn't have expected to be able to do in the game, that is a magic moment for us. That's what we live for. I watched a guy the other day do something I'd never seen in Dishonored before. He was running away after killing off a couple of high-profile assassination targets, two members of parliament, and he was up high on a balcony. And the jump would have killed him because it was maybe four stories up. But he had the possession power. And in our game, when you possess somebody, it's not like you leave your body behind and possess them with your mind. It's a corporeal thing, so you move physically into them, and then you pilot them around. And so he jumped off of this balcony four stories up and plummeted to the ground, and I thought he was going to die. He was on the pavement next to the river. But he was angling for this guard that was walking a patrol down there, and as he got close to the guard, he activated the possession power and moved into the guy, and it kills the inertia of the fall, and he lived and walked past the other guards who didn't know anything was wrong. And that is a moment you can't have in another game.
What's happening?
Once a programmer came back to us and he shot a little video of something that was really fun and wanted to show us. So what he did was that he summoned a set of rats, then he froze time, then he pulled out the spring razor, which is this kind of mine that you can stick to things. So he could actually froze the rat, stick the mine to the rat, then he possessed the rat, and then he moved the rat around and close to a guard and ejected as the mine exploded.
I think what is special to Dishonored is that the moment-to-moment emotion is great. In a shooter, for example, you know that shooting at a guy will kill you, and you have to take cover and progress and... Well. But in Dishonored, you can combine things in a way that even the result can be unpredictable.
For us, the thing that is a thrill is whenever we are surprised by the game. We see that for the first time, like a character responding to something, all those powers will chain together, and still the simulation works. For us, it's really mind-blowing.
What I like to do when I'm playing games, you know, to share experiences, every player experience would be pretty different. I would love the player to feel that.
Everything is now set in stone. We're moving toward the finish line. And we go from being directors early on to being testers.
Everything is there. It's like a movie where, you know, you can see it all together and edit it and you know, apply some process there, refocus there.
It's just a magical moment when you get to the point where people on the team start finishing the game from beginning to end. That's when you can get some of your most meaningful feedback, you know, and some of your most meaningful tweaks to the player experience.
To see it in its entirety felt like some sort of an incredible achievement.
The freedom that you have, it's amazing.
This chance that you have to actually experience being an assassin in first person with all his powers is very unique.
There are ups and downs and moments of mystery and surprise that are the revealing shots and the discovery of a new area or a new type of gameplay.
We try to have verticality in our game. Like, you can jump everywhere, you can climb everywhere, you can blink everywhere.
Try to blend the settings, the story and the mechanics all together to try to make something really immersive.
Like, you have a lot of choices, and every choices that you make are making your experience so that every experience is different for every player.
It's a mixture of romantic, mysterious atmosphere and a lot of violence and adrenaline mixed together.
I hope that the players will feel like a supernatural assassin and that they really get to express the way they want to play and make all those choices moment to moment.
and feel really good about it and be thrilled when they see the consequences and that the world is actually reacting to what they do.
We love this type of game with a stealth element and action and simulation behind all the player powers. And it's only once every blue moon that we get to work on this type of game.
But the results of so many years of working hard, and suddenly you see it like coming out, and it's it feels really, really good for all of us.
You know, we're creating worlds, and we are creating life in a way. So when you see a game, I think it's pretty special. I love it.
People out there can sense and feel quality above a certain level. So no matter what genre you do, no matter what medium you use, if you strive for perfection and you have amazing craftsmanship, people out there would know that it's not a marketing gimmick, it's not a sales technique that you're packaging into something, but it's something that's awesome and they have to have it.
In Dishonored 1, periodically you get drawn into the void. The realm where the outsider lives. We get asked about the outsider a lot. He's obviously a mythic, enigmatic figure. And so we give you a little more detail on the outsider this time. His history, how he came into the world 4,000 years ago. He's a figure neither good nor evil, who looks across time and space and is sometimes inactive for long periods of time.
Empress Emily Kaldwin. I am a friend of your father's from the bad old days.
When there are people that he believes are going to be pivotal to history, sometimes he selects them, offers them his mark, which grants them enormous supernatural powers.
Burns from the inside.
And then he's almost watching, expecting them cynically to abuse those powers. He seems obsessed with the abuse of power and how the powerful treat the powerless. The new version of the Outsider is definitely true to the character, but we assume that different people see him differently.
Another surprise. So be it.
We leave him to the players to infer, to interpret, but he's an interesting character. And then on top of that, the void itself is different. It's darker. It's a little more disturbing, perhaps.
You never thought I'd be here again.
This time, for Dishonored 2, we've tried to answer some of the questions that really gnawed at players the first time. But a big part of our philosophy is for every question we answer, we try to ask a new one. When we wrapped Dishonored 1 and the DLC, we started thinking about Emily Kaldwin as protagonist. It became kind of a bit of an obsession for us.
Welcome, Lady Emily Kaldwin.
To see Emily and treat her the right way, like think really how would she grow up, what would she look like, how would she carry herself. So it's 15 years after the Rat Plague, after the first Dishonored, and Corvo's been training her for 15 years, telling her, someday our enemies are gonna come for you with knives and you have to be ready. Then otherworldly usurper takes the throne. For the first time, as an adult, driven out of her home, she has to flee. And so the contrast for her is huge. She was an empress one day, the next day she's on the run. And she's trying to unravel the Duke of Sirkonos and his allies in order to win back her own throne. And so part of it is just like, take back what's yours. But at the same time, she begins to see the corrupting influences of bad leadership. Her motivation becomes, I need to take back the empire so that I can do right by the people.
When we decided that Emily got to have her own powers, they needed to be interesting enough to be as cool as Corvo.
Her mobility power is called Far Reach, where it's more elastic than Blink. It's not so much a short-range teleport as it's almost like a supernatural grapple. It allows you to pull yourself through the world. You can slingshot past things. You can grab people and pull them toward you and assassinate them in midair. You can pull objects toward yourself. Far Reach can be upgraded in different ways.
Domino is that power that allows you to link the fate of characters in the world, and whatever happens to one, happens to the other.
If you look at her powers, most of them are befitting of an empress. She can link people together so that they share the same fate. She can mesmerize a crowd of people.
There you are. I feel so empty right now.
She's also a young woman who lived a pretty privileged life, punctuated by a brief time of darkness.
All hail Her Imperial Majesty, Emily Kaldwin.
She uses Shadow Walk and she becomes this inky monstrosity, and then for a brief time, does some terrible things, and then goes back to being the person that she normally is.
And then it gets a bit crazy because Emily also has the power of doppelganger, where she can create a reflection of herself.
It can be used to distract AI enemies, or it can be upgraded so that it's actually lethal and it can assassinate. So whether you play Emily or Corvo, you work your way through the same set of missions. But that said, Emily's commentary on the world is sometimes similar to Corvo's, but sometimes it's different based on her perspective.
I wish I could just run away from all this.
Sometimes you do.
And one of the underlying themes of the game is that Emily, as Empress, is used to depending on a lot of other people to get what she needs. And in this situation, she's really only got herself to depend on. And then on top of that, because she is a former Empress and Empress on the run, people react very differently when they see her than they do to Corvo.
All that, and you have your father's eyes, your Imperial Majesty.
We just had to do Corvo again because we're so nostalgic about the character. First of all, we really wanted to see what Corvo felt like with a voice.
Every year, I think the anniversary of Jessamine's death will be easier, but it never is.
In Dishonored 2, it's 15 years after the rat plague, after the first game, and Corvo is wondering, how long can I protect my daughter? He's seen a lot, he's still facing these crazy threats to the throne and to the Empire. And so Corvo is like a man reflecting on the winter of his life. He's both the badass supernatural assassin we wanted him to be, and he's very thoughtful. And of course, Corvo is a foreigner. That's part of his character. He's originally from Syrkonos. At the start of Dishonored 2, he's on the run from Dunwall Tower. This time he's going down into his native country. He's seeing Syrkonos again for the first time in a long time. He's seeing how it's changed under the Duke of Syrkonos. And so it's a land that's familiar to him and unfamiliar at the same time.
Corvo comes back with all his powers, and what we wanted to do is not only put them in the new engine, but also find interesting tweaks or improvement to them.
It's interesting to look at Corvo's powers. He was a guy who was marked by the outsider during the rat plague when half the city was dead by plague. And so he has Devouring Swarm. You can now upgrade it so that you have two swarms of rats and larger swarms of rats. You can have a swarm that follows you around, Pied Piper style. And those are just some of the upgrades under Devouring Swarm. He's also a foreigner. He's from a different place and he never quite fit in Dunwall. And so he has the power of possession where he can literally embody someone else and walk around in their skin.
We loved possession. It's this ability that allows you to physically enter a character or an animal at first and exit somewhere else. So you actually use the character or the animal as a vessel to move through the world. And we added some upgrades that allow you, for instance, to chain hosts. Another cool kind of weird upgrade is that you're now allowed to possess corpses if you choose this upgrade. Suddenly, it's not about movement, it's about creating hiding spots for yourself. Each time you knock someone down or you kill him, it becomes a hiding place.
What the?
One of Corvo's classic powers that fans absolutely love because it's so crazy over the top is bend time. Initially, he has the ability to slow time and then he can upgrade it so he can stop time altogether. This time, we also allow you to spool time forward a little bit. Pressing a button or pulling a trigger, you can allow it to advance a little bit until things get exactly into the position that you want. It's very powerful. One of Corvo's signature powers from the first game is Blink. It's sort of a short-range teleport. When we were working on the DLC for Dishonored 1, we gave Doubt a kind of a redirective blink that allows you to move out into space, stop time, rotate, and continue your blink back in the direction you came or in another direction. And so we knew that's one upgrade we wanted to add to Corvo for Blink in the new game. And it really does allow players to explore their environment.
It's not only about expanding the powers, but expanding them in a way that is fun, that allows for that kind of creative play.
Plus, the new system for the supernatural powers, where we give upgrades for all of them and allow the player to go deeper on those and explore those mechanics and how they interact with stealth and combat situations. Players are really going to be torn. The new thing with Emily or the nostalgic thing with Corvo.
Right now, if you asked me to choose between the two, I would be hard-pressed because I love them both. Like it's like choosing between your children.
We're really just excited about doing another culture, another city. And so that's why we wanted to move down to Karnaca.
My wish was to go at the edge of this world in a city where the sun is impacting a lot the mood. And it was allowing us to create some weird atmosphere and to twist things. I proposed Karnaca because to me it was really, really different.
It's closer to the equator, there's more vegetation, it's more of a
blended culture.
The atmosphere is way more dense. It's based on a photo trip I did in Long Beach, Los Angeles. Well, at sunset, the sun makes the atmosphere coming really thick. The sun is super weird.
As we talk about the dances, the foods, the songs, the different weather, how wealthy people would go take in the sun on the beach to sort of cure their maladies. One of the things we also talked about was the demographic of where the various people came from.
It's really important to build the history of a city. So we started 2 centuries before the action takes place. In my imagination, there were natives on this island. And then I imagined a wave of settlers from Morlaix, which is an island that we never visited in Dishonored. These are these tall, blonde guys. They are bulky. They've started a small village with the natives. We decided to bring some people from Bristol, from Dunwall. They split the island in 2, making a huge canal. It was making a direct link to Dunwall. That means people from different countries working together, fighting together. It was a nice setup for the story of the game. So we were done with the shape, the landmass around the city. It was time to bring this industrial flavor that everyone was in love with in Dishonored 1. I was pushing to have something really unique. So that's why we had this giant peak. What if we have wind that goes through this giant peak and have shaped a wind corridor? My first idea was to set up silver quarries there. And what if we put a district there where people suffer? Imagine how they think and how they survive in this district that brought a lot of different structures, like the windbreaker, the way the blocks in the district are shaped in diamond shape to funnel the wind, to break the wind. The giant mills, it ends up with something really, really cool story-wise and visually.
Focused a lot more on verticality. When you travel to Karnaca in Dishonored 2, you'll see the contrast on the rooftops. There are far fewer of the A-frame roofs, and instead you have a flatter rooftop. Obviously has gameplay ramifications.
It adds so much freedom to the original experience. Now you can access the roof with blink, balconies, or you can take the stairs, or you can climb on the light poles. The fact that you have more space to play in, I think it's a good thing.
One thing that I like to think about Dishonored 2, and Dishonored in general, is that some people have labeled it as a stealth game, an action game, but I think it's even more than that. It has some element of an exploration game. It's not only about the fighting, it's not only about the sneaking, it's also about like discovering the space, slowly getting your bearings, orienting yourself in the city, understanding how it works, how the people there how they react, different factions.
The fact that there are neutral factions also allows the player to explore without fearing to be attacked, which is a good thing because the artist has done such great objects, totally typical to Dishonored.
At Arkane, we focus a lot on the really small details in the world. You can sneak, enter apartment, and review what's there. For example, the typewriter that everyone is loving. People really love when it's functional, and now if you press spacebar, you hear the sound, you see it moving. We design each object so they can be built in real life. I really think that returning fans and new players will be blown away by the richness of this new city and this world 15 years later.
One of the big principles that we have at Arkane is to say yes to the player.
At the beginning of the game, you're faced with a choice between Corvo or Emily, and then you're faced with a choice of which pathway to take through this crazy non-linear space. Open the window, front door, back door, you know, like down the street, over the rooftop. And then on top of that, you're faced with the playstyle question. Do you sneak and try to avoid killing people? Do you sneak and kill as many people as possible? Do you just kick the front door in and fight your way through? In terms of the missions themselves, we wanted to do classic Dishonored missions where it's a highly defended location, it has its own character, it has its own nature, and you're going after a high-value target. But we also wanted to give them some sort of epic theming, either fictionally or game mechanically, so that it just created like a completely memorable space to move around in.
So for example, in Cracking the Slab, which is a level where you have the ability to go back and forth in time.
You can literally move back and forth very dynamically between 2 time periods, the present, when the house is in ruins, or the past, 3 years ago, on the night of a special event, when the house is posh, candles are lit, music is playing, guards are walking around.
It's a very different feel.
The challenge for us was to create two and even three different levels that would be fun to play and where the player could go whenever he wants.
In the Dust District, you have these raging storms that come about randomly. You have two targets there, two factions with very different ideas about what's better for the future.
The other level that is very special in my heart is Clockwork Mansion, where the player can change the configuration of each room.
Where you could throw levers and move the walls, floor, and ceiling around. You basically reconfigure the house like a Rubik's Cube. So you can do that not only to open up new passages, but also to lock enemies behind walls. You're trying to reach Kirin Jindosh, the grand inventor for the Duke of Sirkonos, and you're trying to unlock this puzzle box of his house, one layer at a time, to reach him. Another one of our very themed levels is the Royal Conservatory. It's like a massive museum with taxidermied animals that kind of gives you a view into like the Victorian idea of natural philosophy and science of the time. It just feels atmospheric and grandiose.
What happens when the player's decisions meet this story-rich world is what we call emergent narrative. You can encounter a situation and react according to your morality, to your knowledge of the world, or to your impulses right now. And then you create your own story.
If there's one thing that I want the player to feel about Dishonored 2, is that our missions, our levels, whereas they're not open world, they feel like open world.
Given that in one playthrough of Dishonored 2, you probably see 20% of the game, it feels to us like no two players will have exactly the same path.
We've put so much effort into having so many things to do, so many ways to do things, so many choices. I would like the player to feel like the possibilities are endless.
When a player engages with a game like ours, one of the primary goals from a development and design standpoint is to let them play improvisationally.
The way that we allow for so much player freedom, the play your way philosophy as we like to call it, is that your game will inevitably be a hybrid.
All movements are linked. Everything has a purpose. It's all connected, you see.
Because you allow the player to do whatever he wants, he needs to be able to sneak, he needs to be able to fight, he needs to be able to steal, to look through keyholes, climb, anything the player can imagine.
We try to give the player enough flexible verbs, basically, and whenever possible, we give them non-combat actions that just let them play at their own pace. It's not just about going left, right, over the top of the building, possessing a fish and swimming along in the river. All of those crazy things you can do, using combat or stealth or being very violent or not killing anyone. It's not just about that. It's just the moment to moment, the feeling of when something happens as a direct result of your actions.
It's your experience. For instance, we see player arriving in front of a firing squad in the street, and some of them just walk right past it. Some other people are like, is there loot to steal? And some other people approach it like morally, hey, what did these people do exactly? I think I'm gonna defend them.
We are really attached to our character because we meet them in a lot of situations. We attached a lot of attention to create characters that feel real and from this city.
Dishonored 2 is not just about the depth of the world and the atmosphere of the setting. It's really a stealth game.
Compliance is mandatory.
You can either use the stealth a little bit to like sneak up on somebody and take them out, or you can try to play the game without anyone seeing you at all.
Clearly, stealth is a key pillar of Dishonored, and it's still, of course, a key pillar of Dishonored 2. For instance, Shadow Walk, you can take this like shadowy inky form and use it as a stealth power, but it can also be used to kill people.
But we've added many more non-lethal options as well. Drop assassination was very popular before, but now you can land and knock them out. We've added a combat choke that allows you not only to like break out of combat and non-lethally subdue somebody, but you can also use it to drag them around, use them as a human shield, throw them at an enemy. So there are just many more options just in the basics of combat and subdual.
Not sure I'd call it mercy.
If you just want the cathartic experience of chopping dudes' heads off and shooting them in the chest, dropping on them from the top of a building, taking out as many corrupt guards and aristocratic weasels as you want, Dishonored can definitely be approached that way.
No!
For Dishonored 1, we had the outsider mark you, giving you supernatural powers.
It burns from the inside.
When the outsider offers you his mark, this time in Dishonored 2, you could say no.
No,
I never asked for your help, and I don't need it now.
What does it mean for you? It means that you won't have any power throughout the game. And for us, level designer, it means that you should be able to do everything that the other guys could do with the powers. Sometimes it's more difficult, but at the end of the day, you can finish the game without any power.
What are you waiting for?
It might sound pretty counterintuitive. As a designer, you build all those like fun, original, sometimes very complicated to actually implement systems. And then you include in your game an option to, you know, lock them away? Why?
No. Whatever you're offering, I can make my own way.
That's, I think, because we are confident that our core gameplay is interesting enough. And we are confident that the player who makes that choice wants that kind of experience. He wants to be a human being among human beings and feel like he's the best. Like, he wants to be Batman and not Superman.
We have players who play for the story. We have players who play because they have stealth simulation, because they think Emily's cool or Corvo's cool. Some players move through the game like a shadow without leaving anyone disturbed, and other players leave a big trail of blood and body parts.
I present the lost sister of Jessamine Kaldwin. Delilah Kaldwin.
Impossible.
I'm here to relieve you of your crown.
But someone yanked the rug from under your feet. You've lost your throne and your father. And I promise, Delilah won't just give them back.
No!
So, what are you prepared to do about it, Your Imperial Majesty? Playing the long games. And now she's an empress. How many of your own subjects are you ready to slaughter? And what are you willing to become?
We'll be face to face soon, Delilah. Here's soda.
B, C, D, E, N, G, H, I, J, K, Elemental. V, X, Y, Z.
Hey!
Anyone here? Show yourself!
It's not my job to clean up.
Give me a handful of the clockwork.
Down. Kieran Jindosh.
Well, well, someone's been tampering here.
There's another choice here. With this machine, maybe you won't have to die after all, Jindosh. Not sure I'd call it mercy.
Playback for detection registered. Playback. Playback for detection registered. Aristocratic profile, but hostile. Combat protocol 8.
Search.
Playback for Compilation. Housing breach.
Philosopher.
Damn Sokoloff! He will haunt me to my grave!
Chloe Grace Moretz was good enough to lend her voice to a character named Emily, who's quite important.
I love getting in the booth and just kind of playing with the different voices and sounds and stuff you can make and trying to really get the acting through onto the video game.
Susan Sarandon, I'm older, so I'm a big fan of hers from as far back as the Rocky Horror Picture Show days. And she plays an interesting character that I don't want to say too much about right now. So those guys bring their own ideas to what the character's feeling and the intensity. And so just talking purely in narrative terms, I think the voice actors add a level of polish and help the player just sort of like empathize with what's going on.
I want the Dishonored world to leave a souvenir and a memory in the player as if they had really been to this place and it moved them. And I hope it would stay in fiction as one of the places that will give people goosebumps and shivers.
The thing we really wanted to do was give the player decisions to make, give the player choices and have some consequences to those choices. And some have lightweight or subtle consequences, and some are purely aesthetic.
Choice matter because in the media of video game, you can make choices where the movies doesn't allow you to make choices. So having the consequences to what you do and seeing how the simulation deals with your choices, it feels like the player has full ownership of his experience.
My goal is that everything that the player wants to do, he should be able to do it. As you can go everywhere, then it has to be functional everywhere. If he sees a door, it's an opponable door. If he sees a roof, he should be able to climb there, and he knows that this is a valid path.
As you guide Corvo through the world, as you see this world from a first-person perspective, you can constantly approach the game with all-out violence or subtlety, like, you know, you can be very surgical in how you move into an environment and how you deal with the assassination target.
Ce qui est vraiment très très intéressant dans Dishonored, c'est la possibilité pour le joueur de vraiment inventer son histoire, on va dire. Il peut vraiment jouer le jeu de la façon dont il a vraiment envie. Il peut très bien jouer au jeu sans jamais tuer personne, ou alors être une bête sauvage et attaquer tout le monde, mais ça aura des conséquences dans le jeu.
I feel like we might have made the first assassination game where you don't actually have to kill anybody.
L'IA dans Dishonored est assez particulière dans le sens où il faut qu'elle réagisse vraiment à tout ce que le joueur est capable de faire, que ce soit de par ses pouvoirs ou de ce que ce soit que le joueur peut être assez.
We were done with the shape, the landmass around the city. It was time to bring this industrial flavor that everyone was in love with in Dishonored 1. I was pushing to have something really unique. So that's why we have this giant peak. What if we have wind that goes through this giant peak and have shaped a wind corridor? My first idea was to set up silver quarries there. And what if we put a district there where people suffer? Imagine how they think and how they survive in this district that brought a lot of different structures like the windbreaker, the way the blocks in the district are shaped in diamond shape to funnel the wind, to break the wind. The giant mills, it ends up with something really, really cool story-wise and visually.
We've focused a lot more on verticality. When you travel to Karnaca in Dishonored 2, you'll see the contrast on the rooftops. There are far fewer of the A-frame roofs, and instead you have a flatter rooftop. Obviously has gameplay ramifications.
It adds so much freedom to the original experience. Now you can access the roof with blink, the balconies, or you can take the stairs, or you can climb on the light poles. The fact that you have more space to play in, I think it's a good thing.
One thing that I like to think about Dishonored 2, and Dishonored in general, is that some people have labeled it as a stealth game, an action game, but I think it's even more than that. It has some element of an exploration game. It's not only about the fighting, it's not only about the sneaking, it's also about like discovering the space, slowly getting your bearings, orienting yourself in the city, understanding how it works, how the people there how they react, different factions.
The fact that there are neutral factions also allows the player to explore without fearing to be attacked, which is a good thing because the artist has done such great objects, totally typical to Dishonored.
At Arkane, we focus a lot on the really small details in the world. You can sneak, enter apartments, and review what's there. For example, the typewriter that everyone is loving. People really love when it's functional, and now if you press spacebar, you hear the sound, you see it moving. We design each object so they can be built in real life. I really think that returning fans and new players will be blown away by the richness of this new city and this world 15 years later.
One of the big principles that we have at Arkane is to say yes to the player.
At the beginning of the game, you're faced with a choice between Corvo or Emily, and then you're faced with a choice of which pathway to take through this crazy non-linear space. Open the window, front door, back door, you know, like down the street, over the rooftop. And then on top of that, you're faced with the playstyle question. Do you sneak and try to avoid killing people? Do you sneak and kill as many people as possible? Do you just kick the front door in and fight your way through?
And could we be a hybrid?
All movements are linked. Everything has a purpose. It's all connected, you see.
Because you allow the player to do whatever he wants, he needs to be able to sneak, he needs to be able to fight, he needs to be able to steal, to look through keyholes, climb, anything the player can imagine.
We try to give the player enough flexible verbs, basically, and whenever possible, we give them non-combat actions that just let them play at their own pace. It's not just about going left, right, over the top of the building, possessing a fish and swimming along in the river, all of those crazy things you can do, but using combat or stealth or being very violent or not killing anyone. It's not just about that. It's just the moment to moment, the feeling of when something happens as a direct result of your actions.
It's your experience. For instance, we see players arriving in front of a firing squad in the street, and some of them just walk right past it. Some other people are like, is there loot to steal? And some other people approach it like morally, hey, what did these people do exactly? I think I'm gonna defend them.
We are really attached to our character because we meet them in a lot of situations. We attached a lot of attention to create characters that feel real and from this city.
Dishonored 2 is not just about the depth of the world and the atmosphere of the setting. It's really a stealth game.
Compliance is mandatory.
You can either use the stealth a little bit to like sneak up on somebody and take them out, or you can try to play the game without anyone seeing you at all.
Clearly, stealth is a key pillar of Dishonored, and it's still, of course, a key pillar of Dishonored 2. For instance, Shadow Walk, you can take this like shadowy inky form and use it as a stealth power, but it can also be used to kill people.
But we've added many more non-lethal options as well. Drop assassination was very popular before, but now you can land and knock them out. We've added a combat choke that allows you not only to like break out of combat and non-lethally subdue somebody, but you can also use it to drag them around, use them as a human shield, throw them at an enemy. So there are just many more options just in the basics of combat and subdual.
Not sure I'd call it mercy.
If you just want the cathartic experience of chopping dudes' heads off and shooting them in the chest, dropping on them from the top of a building, taking out as many corrupt guards and aristocratic weasels as you want, Dishonored can definitely be approached that way. For Dishonored 1, we had the outsider mark you, giving you supernatural powers.
It burns from the inside.
When the outsider offers you his mark, this time in Dishonored 2, you could say no.
No. I never asked for your help, and I don't need it now.
What does it mean for you? It means that you won't have any power throughout the game. And for Earth-level designer, it means that you should be able to do everything that the other guys could do with the powers. Sometimes it's more difficult, but...
To upset you, my lord.
Wait. I thought, maybe you should dress up like her. I think I should like to teach her a lesson.
Lord Pendleton, are you okay?
So because these things can happen dynamically almost anywhere, the lines are unscripted for characters commenting on whether, you know, you look sickly or not when you're possessing someone. So here the players used a sleep dart to knock out this courtesan.
So here we're going to demonstrate one of the ways we can combine powers. Here in this case, the player jumped off the building and would have killed himself normally, but instead what he did is that he used the possession power on that woman and therefore projected himself into her body and then could walk around this way without dying.
What's happening to me?
Those are things that when we designed the powers, we did not know the extent of the possibilities, and then like looking at players, finding them out is really, really satisfying for us. And this is the end of our stealth playthrough.
In this playthrough, we try a more direct approach of the Golden Cat mission.
Okay, so this time the player has done a different sequence leading through the streets leading up to the Golden Cat, and it has come in through the rooftops. So a lot of vertical movement in the game, a lot of mobility. In the previous area, you can get dropped off in the river, and you're here to kill Custis and Morgan Pendleton. And therefore, there are several different ways to enter the Golden Cat area. In this playthrough, we're going to do very brutally.
Can encounter a situation and react according to your morality, to your knowledge of the world, or to your impulses right now. And then you create your own story.
If there's one thing that I want the player to feel about Dishonored 2, is that our missions, our levels, whereas they're not open world, they feel like open world.
Given that in one playthrough of Dishonored 2, you probably see 20% of the game, It feels to us like no two players will have exactly the same path.
We've put so much effort into having so many things to do, so many ways to do things, so many choices. I would like the player to feel like the possibilities are endless.
When a player engages with a game like ours, one of the primary goals from a development and design standpoint is to let them play improvisationally.
The way that we allow for so much player freedom, the play your way philosophy as we like to call it, is that your game will inevitably be a hybrid.
All movements are linked. Everything has a purpose. It's all connected, you see.
Because you allow the player to do whatever he wants, he needs to be able to sneak, he needs to be able to fight, he needs to be able to steal, to look through keyholes, climb, anything the player can imagine.
We try to give the player enough flexible verbs, basically, and whenever possible, we give them non-combat actions that just let them play at their own pace. It's not just about going left, right, over the top of the building, possessing a fish and swimming along in the river. All of those crazy things you can do, using combat or stealth or being very violent or not killing anyone. It's not just about that. It's just the moment to moment, the feeling of when something happens as a direct result of your actions.
It's your experience. For instance, we see player arriving in front of a firing squad in the street, and some of them just walk right past it. Some other people are like, is there loot to steal? And some other people approach it like morally, hey, what did these people do exactly? I think I'm gonna defend them.
We are really attached to our character because we meet them in a lot of situations. We attached a lot of attention to create characters that feel real and from this city.
Dishonored 2 is not just about the depth of the world and the atmosphere of the setting, it's really a stealth game.
Compliance is mandatory.
You can either use the stealth a little bit to like sneak up on somebody and take them out, or you can try to play the game without anyone seeing you at all.
Clearly, stealth is a key pillar of Dishonored, and it's still, of course, a key pillar of Dishonored 2. For instance, Shadow Walk, you can take this like shadowy inky form and use it as a stealth power, but it can also be used to kill people.
But we've added many more non-lethal options as well. Drop assassination was very popular before, but now you can land and knock them out. We've added a combat choke that allows you not only to like break out of combat and non-lethally subdue somebody.
They train the overseers to be real religious.
Thank you.
and this is the end of our stealth playthrough.
In this playthrough, we try a more direct approach of the Golden Cat mission.
Okay, so this time the player has done a different sequence leading through the streets leading up to the Golden Cat, and it has come in through the rooftops. It's a lot of vertical movement in the game, a lot of mobility. In the previous area, you can get dropped off in the river, and you're here to kill Custis and Morgan Pendleton. And therefore, there are several different ways to enter the Golden Cat area. In this playthrough, we're going to do very brutally.
Are you okay?
Now Morgan's on the first floor.
Need to get the men in position.
The Ivory Room. All I can tell you is, it's very heavily soundproofed. I'll leave the rest to your imagination. Custis is easier than me.
Why would anyone pay for that?
Rats. Plague. Licks. Bunch of crap.
Huh?
This is a drop attack.
Talk to that nice girl again. The one I told you about. But you're at the Golden Cat, right? Yeah.
Obviously, playing this way has got consequences. Some of them is that we track the number of death and innocents that the player kill, and this derives the ending, but also derives some of the little story beats all along the game. And besides, playing this way is actually very consuming in terms of resource. So the player uses those resources like powers and his mana and his health potions, and he has to use them carefully.
Might be worth checking out.
Take out his legs!
People there leave how they react, different factions.
The fact that there are neutral factions also allows the player to explore without fearing to be attacked, which is a good thing because the artist has done such great objects, totally typical to Dishonored.
At Arkane, we focus a lot on the really small details in the world. You can sneak into our apartment and review what's there. For example, the typewriter that everyone is loving. People really love when it's functional. And now, if you press spacebar, you hear the sound, you see it moving. We design each object so they can be built in real life. I really think that returning fans and new players will be blown away by the richness of this new city and this world 15 years later.
One of the big principles that we have at Arkane is to say yes to the player.
At the beginning of the game, you're faced with a choice between Corvo or Emily, and then you're faced with a choice of which pathway to take through this crazy non-linear space. Open the window, front door, back door, you know, like down the street, over the rooftop. And then on top of that, you're faced with the playstyle question. Do you sneak and try to avoid killing people? Do you sneak and kill as many people as possible? Do you just kick the front door in and fight your way through? In terms of the missions themselves, we wanted to do classic Dishonored missions where it's a highly defended location, it has its own character, it has its own nature, and you're going after a high-value target. But we also wanted to give them some sort of epic theming, either fictionally or game mechanically, so that it just created like a completely memorable space to move around in.
So for example, in Cracking the Slab, which is a level where you have the ability to go back and forth in time.
You can literally move back and forth very dynamically between two time periods, the present, when the house is in ruins, or the past, 3 years ago, on the night of a special event, when The house is posh, candles are lit, music is playing, guards are walking around. It's a very different feel.
The challenge for us was to create two and even three different levels that would be fun to play and where the player could go whenever he wants.
In the Dust District, you have these raging storms that come about randomly. You have two targets there, two factions with very different ideas about what's better for the future.
The other level that is very special in my heart is Clockwork Mansion, where the player can change the configuration of each room.
Where you could throw levers and move the walls, floor, and ceiling around. You basically reconfigure the house like a Rubik's Cube. So you can do that not only to open up new passages, but also to lock enemies behind walls. You're trying to reach Kirin Jindosh, the grand inventor for the Duke of Sirkonos, and you're trying to unlock this puzzle box.
Drill designers are again formed and trained to create things that don't exist and to make them appealing. And industrial design in itself is fiction. I specialized in advanced prototypes for non-existing cars, which are absolutely dream objects. And that's why the training is very useful. And historically, people like Sid Mead, who's designed Blade Runner, was an industrial designer, and he had the attention to detail and to craftsmanship to make up a world and make it very believable. So it's a very obvious relationship between science fiction and industrial design.
So in Dishonored, you play a supernatural assassin in a steampunk city, a city called Dunwall, and the game has what I would describe as a non-photorealistic art style, led by Sebastian Maton and Victor Antonov. When we first started the project, Raph and I kept saying, this is London 1666. It was the last year of the plague and the year of the Great Fire. The city of London at that point is pivotal to the world and pivotal to history.
The early creative influences were historical architectural pictures of London and maps of London. Start with a location. Where is this taking place? All kinds of representations from different artists, painters, photographers, and filmmakers.
As a visual designer, Victor works kind of like a historian. He really proceeds with what-if scenarios. So, okay, what if instead there was this event happening in history?
We looked at specific rooftops, specific smokestacks, and facade ornaments that were very specific only to London and to no other city.
When the first design come back is that it looks very real, even though it's not, but it's kind of believable because our brain kind of process it in a way which just looks like, oh wow, that looks like a place that could exist. And that's why I think his methodology is so powerful to people.
On a étudié en gros les fogs, la nuit, la pluie, les skies qui sont très bas en fait et qui pèsent sur l'expérience du joueur. C'était vraiment une approche qu'on avait de pas faire un jeu où il fait soleil très beau. C'est comment infiltrer la lumière. Donc c'est tout ce qu'on a étudié en allant à Londres. Et ensuite pour le retranscrire dans le jeu, il a fallu faire un petit peu de développement technique pour essayer de modifier la façon dont réagit la lumière avec les éléments du jeu vidéo, c'est-à-dire dans le brouillard, si on peut faire des haze et faire bloomer nos lights. C'est un bon setup pour un jeu vidéo. Et c'est une ville qui comporte une rivière, donc c'était très important pour nous, pour les missions qu'on fait dans notre jeu. En fait, on n'a pas l'approche classique du jeu vidéo. On a vraiment voulu revenir à des bases classiques d'art pur, c'est-à-dire les références qu'on a. Elles n'ont rien à voir avec... on ne fait pas de recherche sur Google, on ne cherche pas à faire de choses génériques, on veut vraiment...
Industrial designer, and he had the attention to detail and to craftsmanship to make up a world and make it very believable. So it's a very obvious relationship between science fiction and industrial design.
So in Dishonored, you play a supernatural assassin in a steampunk city, a city called Dunwall. And the game has what I would describe as a non-photorealistic art style, led by Sebastian Maton and Victor Antonov. When we first started the project, Raph and I kept saying, this is London 1666. It was the last year of the plague and the year of the Great Fire. The city of London at that point is pivotal to the world and pivotal to history.
The early creative influences were historical architectural pictures of London and maps of London. Start with a location. Where is this taking place? All kinds of representations from different artists, painters, photographers, and filmmakers.
As a visual designer, Victor works kind of like a historian. He really proceeds with what-ifs scenarios. So, okay, what if instead there was this event happening in history?
We looked at specific rooftops, specific smokestacks, and facade ornaments that were very specific only to London and to no other city.
When the first design come back is that it looks very real, even though it's not, but it's kind of believable because our brain kind of process it in a way which just looks like, oh wow, that looks like a place that could exist. And that's why I think his methodology is so powerful to people.
On a étudié en gros les fogs, la nuit, la pluie, les skies qui sont très bas en fait et qui pèsent sur l'expérience du joueur. C'était vraiment une approche qu'on avait de pas faire un jeu où il fait soleil très beau. C'est comment infiltrer la lumière. Donc c'est tout ce qu'on a étudié en allant à Londres. Et ensuite pour le retranscrire dans le jeu, il a fallu faire un petit peu de développement technique pour essayer de modifier la façon dont réagit la lumière avec les éléments du jeu vidéo, c'est-à-dire dans le brouillard, si on peut faire des haze et faire bloomer nos lights. C'est un bon setup pour un jeu vidéo. Et c'est une ville qui comporte une rivière, donc c'était très important pour nous, pour les missions qu'on fait dans notre jeu. En fait, on n'a pas l'approche classique du jeu vidéo. On a vraiment voulu revenir à des bases classiques d'art pur, c'est-à-dire les références qu'on a. Elles n'ont rien à voir avec... on ne fait pas de recherche sur Google, on ne cherche pas à faire de choses génériques, on veut vraiment créer quelque chose d'unique.
But the more we worked on the game, the more two things began to happen. As Raph and I and the team collaborated with Victor Antonov and Sebastian Maton, we started moving the game forward and forward in time, you know, until we eventually got to some sort of 1800s.
He looked into the void and saw death itself staring back at him. And finally, Piero knew what he had to do. It would be his greatest creation. Who it was for did not concern him. In due time, all would be revealed.
The beloved Empress dead, and everyone thinks you're the killer. What will you do, Corvo? Dowd, my old friend, what ending will you make for yourself? How the years pass and the bodies fall. Thank you.
hurry so I can see you. In part, I made this place for luxury and spectacle, I suppose, but it's more than that. This place is a testament to engineering itself. Before you stands an invention that will endure beyond my time. The Jindosh Clockwork Soldier, my greatest creation. There you are, magnificent. Now that I see you, I've worked out who you are. Not a hired cutthroat. Your clothes are too fine. An aristocratic thrill seeker? That's closer. You trained with weapons formerly, but are not a salon fencer. There's a good back alley in your movements. All that, and you have your father's eyes, your imperial majesty. Welcome, Lady Emily Kaldwin.
Impressive, Jindosh. Then you must also know why I'm here.
I'd assume my involvement with the Duke brought you to my door. Or maybe you're after washed-up Anton Sokolov, comfortably residing in the assessment chamber. Either way, come find me and take whatever it is you seek. But if you fall, I'll have your body carried to my lab for dissection and study.
I'll see you soon, Jindosh.
Until then.
Clockwork soldiers, there's an interloper in my home.
Combat protocol 6. Nickel of an inch. Each new visitor is another test for the clockwork soldiers. Each makes them better. Tactical mode.
Quarry lost. Unauthorized presence.
Entering combat safe.
You consider the Grand Guard personnel protecting me to be quarry, but you get the best one of my clockwork soldiers. Extraordinary.
You won't get away! Got you!
It's very impressive that you survived, Delilah, and made it down here to...
For 6 months, I tried to forget what I'd done to the Empress and her little girl. Whatever doom was coming, I deserved it. But not yet.
Dunwall burns to the ground, one corner of the Empire will still know your story. Dowd, the Knife of Dunwall. Killer of an Empress.
Black-eyed bastard knew that when my blade stilled the Empress's heart, delivered her daughter to the Lord Regent's men, everything would fall to pieces. And I'm in a strange duel with a mad witch named Delilah.
Are you afraid of me, Dowd? You should be. Poor Dowd. His heart was made of glass. All it took was a dead empress to crack him apart.
We make our choices and take what comes. And sooner or later, in ways we can't always fathom, the consequences come.
He had dedicated his life to knowledge and progress, but throughout the Isles, no one would listen. The Whaleyards were no place for a natural philosopher, but he had nowhere else to go. The poor and hungry gathered there, hoping for a few scraps, and Roseboro wondered if he would soon share their fate. But then, he saw something. Something that made him realize his entire life's work was a waste, and it brought a smile to his face. Roseboro's discovery breathed new life into Dunwall. It made him rich beyond his wildest dreams. But he never took his success for granted. So when young Anton Sokolov came to him with a radical new idea, he couldn't help but give him a chance. Sokolov's ideas ushered Dunwall into a new era of technology. But over time, Roseboro learned that sometimes progress comes at too great a cost. It's a funny thing, ambition. It can take one to sublime heights or harrowing depths. And sometimes they are one and the same. Roseboro learned that lesson all too well. Once there was a boy who knew only fear and loneliness. The boy had heard stories of better days, when Dunwall was a peaceful place. But to him, that's all they were. Stories. Adults could be cruel, but it was the other children who were truly wicked. So he did the only thing he could, hide in the alleys away from the other boys. Find comfort from his only real friend. That night, he realized he wasn't alone. As the outsider approached, the boy barely even noticed as his hand began to itch. From then on, the boy felt different. He was no longer afraid, and he sought out his tormentors. He swarmed over them with the stuff of nightmares. No one would be safe. But he wasn't careful. A gift so powerful can be taken away as easily as it is given. All it takes is a single bite. As his eyes began to weep, he searched in vain for the outsider, but found himself alone once again. He only wanted to see the outsider one last time to thank him, for he would no longer live in fear.
Donc tous les aspects techniques du gameplay, par exemple les pouvoirs, tout ce qui est intelligence artificielle. En tant que programmeur, il faut vraiment penser à toutes les possibilités que le joueur pourra avoir sur le jeu. Raph Hervé arrive des fois avec des demandes de design assez spéciales.
The mechanics are the most important thing. The interactivity is the most important thing in any video game. It's what's central to the medium. But at the same time, we love the narrative layer. We love the sense of being in a gloomy space that you can slowly explore and that feels like no one else has ever been there. You know, it feels like your experience.
As the experience is changing at each corner, we have to be aware of that as level designers. We have to take care of every possible situation.
So supernatural assassin in a steampunk city, new IP, brand new concept. These are all big challenges. At any given moment, you could go left, you can go right, you can go over the roof, you can possess a fish and swim into the place that you're sneaking into. You can approach things violently with the alarms ringing. No one can ever know you were there. And you could kill everyone, every guard, every servant, every, you know, civilian, or you can kill no one in our game. Those are choices that are in the water around you as you play.
Dishonored, for me, first of all, represents adding a new fictional place on the map of important non-existing cities. I draw and I paint, and I was an industrial designer, so technically I was formed to reproduce things that don't exist in a very realistic way. And my tools are mainly light, architecture, and composition. So science fiction cities are my specialty. Industrial designers are again formed and trained to create things that don't exist and to make them appealing. And industrial design in itself is fiction. I specialized in advanced prototypes for non-existing cars, which are absolutely dream objects. And that's why the training is very useful. And historically, people like Sid Mead, whose designed Blade Runner, was an industrial designer, and he had the attention to detail and to craftsmanship to make up a world and make it very believable. So it's a very obvious relationship between science fiction and industrial design.
So in Dishonored, you play a supernatural assassin in a steampunk city called Dunwall. And the game has what I would describe as a non-photorealistic art style, led by Sebastian Maton and Victor Antonov. When we first started the project, Raph and I kept saying, this is London 1666. It was the last year of the plague and the year of the Great Fire. The city of London at that point is pivotal to the world and pivotal to history.
The early credit.
Train the overseers to be real religious.
Thank you. Oh, he's not the worst.
Whenever you enter this mission, the position of the Pendleton Lords is dynamic, so there are several different places they can be.
You can see the level of alertness of the AI. So in this case, there were like those two little indicators on the head of the woman because she almost saw you. And that's feedback so that the player can know if he's currently well hidden or if he's going to be detected.
Here's another note in the world that also duplicates the information that the player gained by eavesdropping earlier, so he now knows where each of the two Lords Pendleton are. With any of our ladies, here the player's peeking through a keyhole and eavesdropping on a guard and the madame of the Golden Cat.
You can notice that the sound is muffled behind closed doors. And the sound actually propagates based on the geometry, which is really interesting for stealth gameplay because it helps you locate very well where the NPCs are around you.
Here the player is choking out Madame Prudence and taking her key, which is the master key to the Golden Cat. He could have just taken the key and left, but instead he wanted to loot the room, so he left her unconscious. So he could have snuck by without alerting her, he could have killed her, or he could leave her choked out on the floor. It's all options.
Talk to that nice girl again. The one I told you about.
You realize you're at the Golden Cat, right?
Yeah, but she's different. She really likes me.
Idiot. She likes your money, not you.
You're just jealous.
Shut up.
Dunstan, the Pendletons are here. You're supposed to be on duty.
Given the fact that the player can approach the game in a variety of different ways, very, very violently.
That is a moment you can't have in another game.
What's happening?
Once a programmer came back to us and he shot a little video of something that was really fun, he wanted to show us. So what he did was that he summoned a set of rats, then he froze time, then he pulled out the spring razor, which is this kind of mine that you can stick to things. So he could actually froze the rat, stick the mine to the rat, then he possessed the rat, and then he moved the rat around and close to a guard and ejected as the mine exploded.
I think what is special to Dishonored is that the moment-to-moment emotion is great. In a shooter, for example, you know that shooting at a guy will kill you, and you have to take cover and progress and well. But in Dishonored, you can combine things in a way that even the result can be unpredictable.
For us, the thing that is a thrill is whenever we are surprised by the game. We see that for the first time, like a character responding to something, all those powers will chain together, and still simulation works. For us, it's really mind-blowing.
What I like to do when I'm playing games, you know, to share experiences, every player experience would be pretty different. I would love the player to feel that.
Everything is now set in stone. We're moving toward the finish line. And we go from being directors early on to being testers.
Everything is there. It's like a movie where, you know, you can see it all together and edit it and, you know, apply some process there, refocus there.
It's just a magical moment when you get to the point where people on the team start finishing the game from beginning to end. That's when you can get some of your most meaningful feedback, you know, and some of your most meaningful tweaks to the player experience.
To see it in its entirety felt like some sort of an incredible achievement.
The freedom that you have, it's amazing.
this chance that you have to actually experience being an assassin in first person with all his powers is very unique.
There are ups and downs and moments of mystery and surprise that are the revealing shots and the discovery of a new area or a new type of gameplay.
We try to have verticality in our game. Like, you can jump everywhere, you can climb everywhere, you can blink everywhere.
Try to blend the settings, the story and the mechanics all together to try to make something really immersive.
Like, you have a lot of choices, and every choices that you make are making your experience so that every experience is different for every player.
A mixture of romantic, mysterious atmosphere and a lot of violence and adrenaline mixed together.
I hope that the players will feel like a supernatural assassin and that they really get to express the way they want to play and make all those choices moment to moment and feel really good about it and be thrilled when they see the consequences.
Great objects, totally typical to Dishonored.
At Arkane, we focus a lot on the really small details in the world. You can sneak, enter apartment, and review what's there. For example, the typewriter that everyone is loving. People really love when it's functional, and now if you press spacebar, you hear the sound, you see it moving. We design each object so they can be built in real life. I really think that returning fans and new players will be blown away by the richness of this new city and this world 15 years later.
One of the big principles that we have at Arkane is to say yes to the player.
At the beginning of the game, you're faced with a choice between Corvo or Emily, and then you're faced with a choice of which pathway to take through this crazy non-linear space. Open the window, front door, back door, you know, like down the street, over the rooftop. And then on top of that, you're faced with the playstyle question. Do you sneak and try to avoid killing people? Do you sneak and kill as many people as possible? Do you just kick the front door in and fight your way through? In terms of the missions themselves, we wanted to do classic Dishonored missions where it's a highly defended location, it has its own character, it has its own nature, and you're going after a high-value target. But we also wanted to give them some sort of epic theming, either fictionally or game mechanically, so that it just created like a completely memorable space to move around in.
So for example, in Cracking the Slab, which is a level where you have the ability to go back and forth in time.
You can literally move back and forth very dynamically between two time periods, the present, when the house is in ruins, or the past, 3 years ago, on the night of a special event, when the house is posh, candles are lit, music is playing, guards are walking around. It's a very different feel.
The challenge for us was to create two and even three different levels that would be fun to play, and where the player could go whenever he wants.
In the Dust District, you have these raging storms that come about randomly. You have two targets there, two factions with very different ideas about what's better for the future.
The other level that is very special in my heart is Clockwork Mansion, where the player can change the configuration of each room.
Where you could throw levers and move the walls, floor, and ceiling around. You basically reconfigure the house like a Rubik's Cube. So you can do that not only to open up new passages, but also to lock enemies behind walls. You're trying to reach Kirin Jindosh, the grand inventor for the Duke of Serkonos, and you're trying to unlock this puzzle box of his house, one layer at a time, to reach him. Another one of our very themed levels is the Royal Conservatory. It's like a massive museum with taxidermied animals that kind of gives you a view into like the Victorian idea of natural.
Come on, sisters! She doesn't stand a chance!
This seems interesting.
Such beauty.
It's a piece of the night black void.
Wake up, sister. We're not done with you yet.
Come on. Don't have time for games.
Where is she?
Karnaka, my Karnaka. Brothers and sisters of my blood. And all the people who make this great city trust the law. This is the Duke, but you must all know my voice by now.
What? Holy shit!
Think about war, we'll give it to them. No matter how many of you I have sacrifice, Draconis will fight for the island to the bitter end.
What?
You're surrounded!
And feel really good about it and be thrilled when they see the consequences and that the world is actually reacting to what they do.
We love this type of game with a stealth element and action and simulation behind all the player powers. And it's only once every blue moon that we get to work on this type of game.
But the results of so many years of working hard, and suddenly you see it like coming out, and it feels really, really good for all of us.
You know, we're creating worlds, and we are creating life in a way. So when you see a game, I think it's pretty special. I love it.
People out there can sense and feel quality above a certain level. So no matter what genre you do, no matter what medium you use, if you strive for perfection and you have amazing craftsmanship, people out there would know that it's not a marketing gimmick, it's not a sales technique that you're packaging into something, but it's something that's awesome and they have to have it.
In Dishonored 1, periodically you get drawn into the void, the realm where the outsider lives. We get asked about the outsider a lot. He's obviously a mythic, enigmatic figure. And so we give you a little more detail on the outsider this time. His history, how he came into the world 4,000 years ago. He's a figure neither good nor evil, who looks across time and space and is sometimes inactive for long periods of time.
Empress Emily Kaldwin, I am a friend of your father's from the bad old days.
When there are people that he believes are going to be pivotal to history, sometimes he selects them, offers them his mark, which grants him enormous supernatural powers.
Burns from the inside.
And then he's almost watching, expecting them cynically to abuse those powers. He seems obsessed with the abuse of power and how the powerful treat the powerless. The new version of the Outsider is definitely true to the character, but we assume that different people see him differently.
Another surprise. So be it.
We leave him to the players to infer, to interpret, but he's an interesting character. And then on top of that, the void itself is different. It's darker. It's a little more disturbing, perhaps.
You never thought I'd be here again.
This time, for Dishonored 2, we've tried to answer some of the questions that really gnawed at players the first time. But a big part of our philosophy is for every question we answer, we try to ask a new one. When we wrapped Dishonored 1 and the DLC, we started thinking about Emily Kaldwin as protagonist. It became kind of a bit of an obsession for us.
Welcome, Lady Emily Kaldwin.
To see Emily and treat her the right way, like think really how would she grow up, what would she look like, how would she carry herself. So it's 15 years after the Rat Plague, after the first Dishonored, and Corvo's been training her for 15 years, telling her, someday our enemies are going to come for you with knives and you have to be ready. Then otherworldly usurper takes
my blood and all the people who make this great city trust the law. This is the Duke, but you must all know my voice by now.
What? Holy shit!
Think about war, we'll give it to them. No matter how many of you I have
come
to sacrifice,
here.
Draconis will fight for the island to the bitter end.
What?
You're surrounded!
Ah!
one beneath my skin. Careful now. I might not let you leave.
I know where you are, coward! I won't let him escape.
My Karnaka, brothers and sisters of my blood, and all of the people who make this great city turn to war.
What? No way!
Hey, something wrong?
I don't feel so well.
Impossible!
Come back here! Ah! Ah!
Streets of Karnaka. Compliance is mandatory.
Not when you're possessing someone. So here the players use the sleep dart to knock out this courtesan.
So here we're going to demonstrate one of the ways we can combine powers. Here, in this case, the player jumped off the building and would have killed himself normally, but instead what he did is that he used the possession power on that woman and therefore projected himself into her body and then could walk around this way without dying.
What's happening to me?
Those are things that when we designed the powers, we did not know the extent of the possibilities, and then like looking at players, finding them out is really, really satisfying for us. And this is the end of our stealth playthrough.
In this playthrough, we try a more direct approach of the Golden Cat mission.
Okay, so this time the player has done a different sequence leading through the streets leading up to the Golden Cat, and it has come in through the rooftops. So a lot of vertical movement in the game, a lot of mobility. In the previous area, you can get dropped off in the river, and you're here to kill Custis and Morgan Pendleton. And therefore, there are several different ways to enter the Golden Cat area. In this playthrough, we're going to do very brutally.
Need to get the men in position.
The ivory room. All I can tell you is it's very heavily soundproofed. I'll leave the rest to your imagination. Custis is easy with me.
Why would anyone pay for that?
Rats. Plague. Licks. Bunch of crap.
Huh?
His heart was made of glass. All it took was a dead empress to crack him apart.
We make our choices and take what comes. And sooner or later, in ways we can't always fathom, the consequences come back to us.
Stealth or being very violent or not killing anyone. It's not just about that. It's just the moment to moment, the feeling of when something happens as a direct result of your actions.
It's your experience. For instance, we see player arriving in front of a firing squad in the street, and some of them just walk right past it. Some other people are like, is there loot to steal? And some other people approach it like morally, hey, what did these people do exactly? I think I'm gonna defend them.
We are really attached to our character because we meet them in a lot of situations. We attached a lot of attention to create characters that feel real and from this city.
Dishonored 2 is not just about the depth of the world and the atmosphere of the setting. It's really a stealth game.
Compliance is mandatory.
You can either use the stealth a little bit to like sneak up on somebody and take them out, or you can try to play the game without anyone seeing you at all.
Clearly, stealth is a key pillar of Dishonored, and it's still, of course, a key pillar of Dishonored 2. For instance, Shadow Walk, you can take this like shadowy inky form and use it as a stealth power, but it can also be used to kill people.
But we've added many more non-lethal options as well. Drop assassination was very popular before, but now you can land and knock them out. We've added a combat choke that allows you not only to like break out of combat and non-lethally subdue somebody, but you can also use it to drag them around, use them as a human shield, throw them at an enemy. So there are just many more options just in the basics of combat and subdual.
Not sure I'd call it mercy.
If you just want the cathartic experience of chopping dudes' heads off and shooting them in the chest, dropping on them from the top of a building, taking out as many corrupt guards and aristocratic weasels as you want, Dishonored can definitely be approached that way. For Dishonored 1, we had the outsider mark you, giving you supernatural powers.
It burns from the inside.
When the outsider offers you his mark, this time in Dishonored 2, you could say no.
No. I never asked for your help, and I don't need it now.
What does it mean for you? It means that you won't have any power throughout the game.
And for Earth-level designer, it means that you should be able to do everything that the other guys could do with the powers. Sometimes it's more difficult, but at the end of the day, you can finish the game without any power.
What are you waiting for?
What's going on here?
It might sound pretty counterintuitive. As a designer, you build all those like fun, original, sometimes very complicated to actually implement systems. Then you include in your game an option to, you know, lock them away? Why?
No. Whatever you're offering, I can make my own way.
That's, I think, because we are confident that our core gameplay
of Jessamine called. Delilah Kaldwin.
Impossible.
I'm here to relieve you of your crown.
But someone yanked the rug from under your feet. You've lost your throne and your father. And I promise, Delilah won't just give them back.
No!
So, what are you prepared to do about it, your Imperial Majesty?
Time the rats win. And here the player has possessed one of his own rats and is now getting away. And that's the end of the violent, messy playthrough of the Golden Cat.
So this is a very different area. The previous area with posh and pretty, this is like desolated, abandoned. This is actually the area where there are weepers. It's called the Flooded District. And there are those tall boys here that are preventing the weepers. The weepers are the plague-infected people. Those tall boys, their job is to prevent them from accessing the rich area. So they will shoot at the weepers and they will shoot at anything that tries to get through, including the player.
Grenade!
Here we're using wind blast to bounce back the arrows at the turbos.
Using wind blast to knock the tall boys' phosphorescent arrows back at them is another combination of game mechanics that we did not plan for, but players found it quite fun, so we made some small changes to help support it. These Stiltwalker guards, the tall boys as they're called, have vulnerable tanks of whale oil on their backs that they use for their incendiary arrows. And so periodically the player is shooting at those tanks, stopping time, trying to get behind them. The shields all around them are actual breakable wooden shields, so they absorb some of the player's shots, but periodically the player breaks one of them off.
Here the player just possessed a tall boy, and he's going to escape the area through those wall of lights here via tall boy.
So the wall of light is a Tesla-like security device that's a powerful electrical field, and the guards at the beginning of their shift are attuned to it so they can walk through it, but the player cannot unless he hacks.